Jayesh for organizing this symposium. Everything is running in time and so well organized. My job is to tell on complications and avoidance. Means I've not done many cases to have so many complications, but then so I have taken of my complications as well as from the literature. What are the possible complications and how it can be avoided? Many of my slides have been already spoken by Dr. Anant and Umesh, so there will be some repetition. As Dr. Anant said, that anteriorly there are three approaches. One is A-leaf and X-leaf and O-leaf. Because you had a lot of complications with A-leaf, a lot of vascular complications with A-leaf, and retrograde ejaculation with A-leaf, people thought X-leaf or D-leaf is better. But D-leaf, as Dr. Anant was telling, one has to go through the psoas or through the psoas muscle. Then there's a potential chance of damaging the lumbar sacral plexus. As one works through the psoas muscle, the lumbar sacral plexus damaged, the chances of weakness is high. And then in these cases, one has to do neuro monitoring. So to overcome this complication, people started doing O-leaf. Here in O-leaf, you don't have to do a neuro monitoring. It's not mandatory because that is the advantage over X-leaf or D-leaf. Some people use neurography as an alternative to find out where to avoid dissecting. Means in the upper part, L2 to L4 is not a problem, but when one comes down, the lumbar sacral plexus overlaps on the posterior half of the body. So sometimes it's difficult. It's not a mandatory to do neurography, as Dr. Srikant told. It is just to have an idea that how is the anatomical orientation. If you divide the body of the lumbar into four segments, each 25%, in the L2, L3, L4, the posterior 50% has the most of the lumbar plexus. But when it comes down, even the anterior part has the part of the lumbar sacral plexus, then it becomes a little tricky. That is why people avoid doing L5, S1 only. So till L4, 5, it's okay. But when one has to resect or displace the anterior border of the psoas at L5, there's a chance that there can be some weakness or because of nerve damage. Basically, the two people have divided the body into Morse zones 1, 2, 3, 4. And 1, 2 is safe to work. And 3 has the psoas muscle and with the lumbar sacral plexus. Most of the time, zone 3 and zone 4 has 90% of the time the lumbar sacral plexus. Zone, and it differs between right and left. But most of the time we work on the left side, so one has to know that 90% one has to work in front, in the front half of the front 50%. Now, Dakar also divided the similar way, that the anterior half of the body is most safe. Whether you do an elif or olif, it's always better to work in the anterior half. But be caution is in L5, the anterior half also is not very safe. Like the anterior zone only is safe. To overcome all this, O-leaf has the advantage, but then in the lower part, one has to be careful. Now, it's not that O-leaf doesn't have complications. There has been a list of lot of publication on complications since 1997. It has been promoted. You can see here, over a period of time, people have published their complications, but then it is quite less compared to the other anterior approaches. The intraoperative complications is almost 1.5%, and the postoperative is 9 to 10%. Fortunately, these post-op complications are not persistent. They usually are transitory, and they have relief within 30 days. And most of the time, the most commonest complication is hypostasia due to damage of hypogastric or ilioinguinal nerve, as Dr. Anant was explaining. In addition to the other common complication is vascular injury. I'll be explaining how to avoid and what are the causes of vascular injury and the nerve damage, as I explained. There can be contralateral nerve root injury also and sympathetic chain injury. Another The sympathetic chain has to be avoided because many times if it's damaged, people complain of change of the temperature. They'll be they keep on one of my patient kept on complaining of increased temperature in the site of surgery. So sympathetic chain has to be saved. All the nerves has to be saved. And the vessels also has to be saved. This anatomy has already been explained that the genitofemoral is on the psoas, and you have the ureter here. You have the sympathetic chain, and you have the segmental vessels. Vascular injury is not very common. It is 2% incident. To avoid that, as Dr. Srikanth told, one has to look at the MRI. The distance between the anterior border of the psoas to the aorta should be minimum 1 centimeter. But then if it's less, as he was explaining, one can do a CT scan in the lateral decubitus position and then see whether the space can be increased or not. If it's less than 1 centimeter, if you still want to do OLIF, one can do a CT scan with the lateral decubitus position, and can see here that the distance increased to so that one can decide whether to do it or not. We'll also do plan the skin incision depending on the lateral decubitus position. But we have been doing with the fluoroscopy, mark the disc space, and then do the incision anterior to the disc space obliquely. To avoid the commonest cause of bleeding is damage to the segmental artery and or vein, the vascular bleeding. But fortunately, if one knows the anatomy, one can avoid damage, because most of the time the segmental artery remains in the upper part of the body. So when one places the pin, it is easy to place the pin in the lower in the upper body on the lower side, but one has to probably avoid putting the pin on the lower side, and especially at L5. As you can see here, also in the second this thing, that always is better because this area has no vessels, so one can usually place the pin, upper pin. The lower pin, it's better to avoid, but if you don't have a vessel, you can place it. But most of the time, if you put a one pin also, doing an OLIF is not difficult. Before placing the needle, always palpate for the disc, especially when putting the pack needle to confirm. Palpate with the finger. Do not blindly put on the bone the pack needle to confirm the disc. Palpate with the finger and then place your needle so that you're always in the disc, because the segmental vessel usually never comes on the disc space. As I was explaining, most of the work can be done with one pin also. And we have been practicing doing our work with one pin and to reduce vascular injury. So both AP and lateral with the one pin. The second most common complication is cage subsidence. It has been reported to almost 8 to 10%. Now, how do you reduce the incidence of cage subsidence? One has to be very careful, especially in elderly people with osteoporotic. In osteoporotic, because there is a lot of change in the density when you put an OLIF graft. So what we have done is we put just iliac crest graft in the shape of an OLIF when we do an anterior approach, and then do posterior fixation. We do not use the graft. But there are some steps to prevent subsidence. One is proper placement. It should be in the middle third, and it should be from pedicle to pedicle, as Dr. Sudhir showed in his surgery. So to have that, one has to, the entry point should be the proper place. If one enters the disc at the center or at the junction of the anterior third and the middle third, then when one places the tubular retractor, we have to work at the center of the body. If one places anterior or posterior, the chances of case migrating or subsidence is higher. And one also has to look at the bone density of the body. When one always go till the opposite side, break the spurs on the opposite side so that one can place the graft from one pedicle to the other pedicle. One has to cross the opposite pedicle and reach this so that the graft subsidence or migration incidence can be reduced. As you can see here, the graft has been placed from beyond the pedicles on both sides. The second step is avoid aggressive end plate removal, and then use adequate bone graft in your in your graft in the olive cage. While using this, do not be very aggressive in removing the epiphyseal plate. That also has a higher chance of graft subsidence. Be very gentle, use a proper size. Don't be over aggressive in putting larger and larger size, because hammering the sizer also can has a chance of breaking the body, and that can cause persistent pain. There is a case report of a vertebral body fracture. I'll show you in the later slide. So what we want to achieve is to have the cage from one pedicle to the other pedicle and the central part of the body. The third precaution is always add lateral or posterior fixation. Many people believe in doing standalone OLIF, though it is not approved. Maybe single level is fine to do a standalone, but more than one level is always add posterior or lateral fixation, or the chances of case subsidence is higher. Like this case, first we did the OLIF and then we supplemented with the posterior fixation with percutaneous fixation. If not posterior, like this case, we did a lateral fixation. But now we have OLIF case where you can put the screws on that side without the rod also. So it's always better to add fixation to prevent subsidence. Now, this was a case report of malposition where they're not placed properly. Now, this is what happens if one does not place it in the center or does being aggressive in removing the epiphyseal plate. And this is what happens to the cage. There is a subsidence, and then they have done three level, and they had not supplemented with posterior fixation also. So if you are doing more than one level, always fix it. Never do over aggressive epiphyseal plate removal, and osteoporotic spine, be careful. So this is again another case report where there is a fracture of the body. Because of over distraction. So do not be over aggressive in distracting. Do whatever is appropriate for that patient. Ureteral incidence injury is not very high. Usually it is detected post-operatively, not intraoperatively. Fortunately, the ureter is adherent to the peritoneum and it remains within this slide Dr. Srikanth also showed that it remains within the two fascia, anterior and posterior fascia of the renal fascia. So if one does separate the, reflects the peritoneum, then normally one does not damage the ureter. So if you don't look for the ureter, you will not damage. If you look for ureter, there is a chance of damage. So reflect the peritoneum along with the ureter, the chances of ureteral damage will be less. Sympathetic chain injury also is less than 1 to 2% as reported in literature. Usually they complain of differential temperature in legs if damaged. The sympathetic chain normally lies in the anterior third of the body. So as Dr. Anant also has stressed that is better to place the retractor, tibular retractor behind the sympathetic chain to avoid damage, because the sympathetic chain is the anterior third of the body. So always place the tibular retractor behind the sympathetic chain, in between the psoas and the sympathetic chain, to prevent damage to the sympathetic chain. The one more complication, which is only case reports, is contralateral nerve root injury. We work OLIF, it is actually obliquely placed, but when you place the cage, it is transversely along this. So many times you have to enter part of the psoas to get the angle. With this, there is chances that you can damage some lumbosacral plexus, especially at L4-5. But if you do not do that, you directly push in your cage, then there are chances that you can have the dural tear or a disc coming out and compressing the opposite side foramen. So this is what has to be avoided. If one does that like this, you can have a post-op deficit on the opposite side or a dural tear. So always place the cage in the center and the trajectory should be in the proper plane. The weakness is not all the time because of a nerve injury. It can be because of psoas muscle injury or a psoas hematoma. So hemostasis has to be achieved properly. Do not damage the psoas muscle, and always remember this anatomy of the lumbosacral plexus on the segments of the vertebral body. The most irritating complication is post-op numbness and paresthesia. It's quite high, almost 10%, but fortunately they are temporary. So attempt is to preserve all the nerves, avoid excessive flexion while positioning the patient, because that can cause neuropraxia. And if it develops also, reassure the patient, treat symptomatically, most of the time they recover. The last complication is radiation dose to the patient and staff. As most many times you have to use the fluoroscopy, all the time we think of only the radiation to us, like patient and the staff, to the doctor around. But then there's a radiation dose also to the patient, especially their young patients. So one has to also think of the number of shots which can be used. So people have started, we have not done navigation guided OLE, where you can do do with the OAM. We have the OAM, but they are not used. And then do everything with navigation guided, probably it reduces the radiation dose to the patient and to the hospital staff. And this is the meta-analysis, the pool data. So, which I already explained, of 1,400 cases of OLIF with the complication rate, which I have already explained. In conclusion, OLIF is a minimal invasive procedure. It has lesser complication compared to other anterior procedures, and long-term follow-up has a similar, the pain relief is similar to the other OLIF procedures with lesser morbidity. Thank you for your attention.